Dernocoeur. I am a, let's see, I have a lot of initials that are kind of turning into former behind my name. I worked as a paramedic in the city and county of Denver from January 1979 until the mid-80s. I did take a little time off during that time to travel extensively for about a year doing reports for GEMS on EMS around the world before internet. And I took another year off to write my first book, which is Street Sense, Communication Safety and Patrol, first edition.
I guess we'll tell us later.
Later on, I became a wilderness EMT through the National Outdoor Leadership School in Wyoming, because I had a chance to do a lot of remote travel, and I was realizing that that credential could be helpful. Took that to search and rescue efforts that I'm still involved with in Michigan, where I live, and the canine unit in particular, the search and rescue unit. And then I also wanted to use the EMT, because I really love running EMS calls, so I went down to my fire department in Ada, Michigan, and became an EMT firefighter, from which I had just retired last month. But I was with them for 7 years. I was the eldest by far in my fire academy class, and I passed, so I'm quite proud of that. And I loved my time on the streets as a medic in the early days of EMS, and before that I was doing work as an EMT for a year, and then before that I was doing wilderness type EMS and EMS training with a fellow out of the New England area. So weekend training sessions in college campuses all over New England. So that was in the early 70s. And then I worked as a dispatcher as well in Vail, Colorado, when Jerry Ford was president. So that was fun. And I learned a lot about dispatching. And I was only there for about a year, but that was a really good education. I'm educated as a journalist, so I took all of that experience and put it into a 25-year career writing for the emergency medical services community.
Awesome.
Which led to speaking at conferences for 20 years. That was a lot of fun. Took time off to go off for a... Then I kind of stopped all of that for a while and did my master's degree as an MFA in creative nonfiction writing. So that's a long answer.
That's a great answer. Do you remember when you decided to get into EMS?
Absolutely.
What caused
you? I know the moment. Actually, I had been working with Greg Betts in the East, doing his mountain and woods oriented first aid and rescue class, which he developed, and which was amazing. It was a 2-day course. I had done a Knowles course, a winter camping 2-week course in the December 1973, and I had prior to that I just always loved bodies, and you know, I was always fascinated with blood and, you know, fixing things, you know, when things went wrong for people, but didn't have a lot of education. I had started with the Vail Mountain Rescue Service when I went off to Knowles, so I was entering that world a little bit. I had taken a first aid class in Eagle, Colorado. The little 75-year-old first aid instructor taught us about diabetic acoma, A-C-O-M-A. She wrote it on the board, and she taught us about eternal bleeding. Very cute. So I was primed. So then I went off to this winter course at Knowles, 2 weeks camping in the Wind Rivers of Wyoming, 35 below temperatures most nights, and it was a whole lot of fun. And then, so one night we were around the campfire, and one of our group leaders, Larry Marlowe, said, yeah, I just took this training. It was really interesting. It's called Emergency Medical Technician. And I remember snapping my fingers and saying, that's what I want to do. And it was a moment that I will not forget. It took me until 1976 to be able to get my EMT. It took a few more years because I was going back and forth to college and between Colorado, where I'm originally from, and the East Coast, where I was being educated. So it took me till 1976 to get my EMT. But that was the moment. I was like, that's what I want to do.
That's awesome.
Right there. Yeah. And you were.
Awesome. Very cool. What was training like for your EMT?
EMT training? So I had been working as a dispatcher in Vail, and I had life got in the way. It was a really, I mean, July 5th, 1977 was not a good day. So I had a little meltdown and I went, long story short, made short, I ended up leaving that job, and then I had already signed up for EMT training at St. Anthony's Hospital in Denver. And I took a little few weeks off and then went to EMT training. So it was a nice junction. So I started fresh in Denver. My mom was living, I'm from Denver, but so the EMT training was, I just ate it up. I couldn't, it was like a starving person getting food. It was just like, I love this stuff. I love it all. But I realized later that both in that training, that was an intensive EMT training. I think it was 2 months of every day, all day. And in those days, I mean, that was a lot. It was sort of standard for EMT at the higher level of we want you to know a lot. So coming out of that training, I got my first job on an ambulance. So I remember just the I was so excited. I was so proud to be, you know, getting through this training I've been trying to get to for 3 years. And then I got hired at a private ambulance service in Denver. And I remember going to my mom and, like, I was so excited. I showed her the uniform code that I'd been given, and I had to go find some brown pants that day and start the next day. And later I understood that this is like the P squared phenomenon. The owners of the company were just looking like, do you have a patch? Do you have a pulse? You're hired. You know, but I was just like on top of the world. I was writing 24-hour shifts, 7 out of every 14 days, and 2 of those would therefore be 48-hour shifts, right? And still, I was like, oh, that's cool. I love those. You know, and then there was like, you're going to pay me $500 a month. Oh, I'm on top of the world. So, I mean, looking back now, I was like, oh, dear God. But, you know, it was a big deal at the time, and just to get paid for what you love to do. And so then I started that, and that whole year of working as an EMT, in those days you had to work for a year on the streets before you could go to paramedic school. So I went right into paramedic school, kind of a little early, kind of the next, I think July or August, I don't remember. But while I was working. So it was intensive. It was very intensive. So you asked about my EMT training. Did you want me to go on?
Sure.
Paramedic training came on the heels of that. And that was at St. Anthony's Hospital in Denver again, with more physician input to the class, particularly a man named Dr. Gerald Gordon, who was the cardiology guru of all of us in Denver, basically. I mean, we called it Gordonology. He wanted us to be able to read EKGs off of 3 leads and a modified chest lead, and we would do basically read axis deviation and, you know, any of the heart blocks, and of course all the dysrhythmias off of these 4 leads that were, you know, you could sort of mimic a 12 lead sort of kind of. And we would consistently outshine his interns in the ED residency program. He would hold us up to them and say, look, these people will teach you how to do this. You know, so we were really, really challenged to be really, really good at what we did. And the others were teaching, mostly they were all doctors and nurses, so which is great. In those days, this is the late 70s, 1978, and I graduated in January of 1979. It was a great education. It was hard. I loved it, ate it up. Clinicals were all with Denver General mostly, and I was also working part-time with A1 Ambulance in Boulder at the time. And I had decided, like, either A1 would get me or Denver would get me, but I was tired of being halfway in the middle.
It's gonna shut off.
Okay, so I ended up at Denver, and my heart wanted to go to Boulder because I was also very actively climbing and doing search and rescue with Rocky Mountain Rescue at that point, and had a boyfriend up that way, and I got hired at Denver. I said, that's it, this is destiny, I'm going this way on this T-junction in my life. And the day before I started at Denver, I had the offer from A1 Boulder. So I was like, my life might have been really different if they had just a week earlier said something to me. So it was my slight preference to go to Boulder. Anyway, I ended up in Denver. It was the place to be working in those days. I was at the point of the spear. Peter Rosen, who wrote the physician's text on NEMSM. And of course, Vince Markovchek and Peter Pons and Dr. Gordon. These were the people, and then later Dr. Norm Dinerman and John Marks and Steve Cantrell. I mean, these physicians were all, we were all on one team, and we were expected to be at such a high level, and we were held up to the nation along with Seattle as like, this is how it can be done. And we were doing a lot of stuff that was just cutting edge. It was so much fun. And I had really, really good mentors. I would look around, you know, the division, and there'd be like these, like, Art Kanowitz and Craig Corey, who both became emergency physicians later on, and Paul Fuller, who came down from Vail, was a close friend, and Jim Dernocoeur, who I married. So, you know, all these people, I would look at how they managed their scenes, and I was like, oh, look, how did they just do that, you know, whatever that was, you know, and I very quickly realized there was a real big deficit in the education. That the doctors and the nurses had no way of knowing was needed, because when I got out on the streets, I started realizing there's this entire body of knowledge that is not being taught. They're based out of the hospitals. Mm-hmm. It's called street sense. Like, put the name to it. And then I started taking notes, because I'm a journalist, right? I'm classically trained as a journalist, and sort of developed, like, okay, there's this area of safety that's not being addressed. There's this area of interpersonal communication that's not being addressed. There's this area of controlling, you know, big scenes and mobs and crowds and stress and death and dying and risk management and what are you doing when you go home at night. All this other, and interpersonal communication as a vehicle to being safe. Safety was, the subtitle of the book is Safety, Communication, Safety, and Control. Without the interpersonal communication, which we were not being taught, it was not part of the curriculum. It was all medicine. And you can't have any safety. We were taught, I could go on, you want to keep going?
Yeah.
We were taught your very first priority on the scene is your ABCs. And that's what I lived for the first year or more. And then I sat down and I said, maybe it's like my safety. Be a little bit more important than the patient's ABCs. Literally, that was not part of the scene. That was not part about what was being taught in those days. And I feel really good that by 1996, I was invited to help with the National Curriculum Rewrite, and Greg Margolis and all those guys up in Pittsburgh were doing that. And I was able to insert a lot of that into the curriculum. So people get that now. They actually learn how to communicate with strangers in crisis and the safety piece that goes with that. And that what is the very first thing we learn in EMT training now is like, or even MFR training, or even basic first aid, the first most important thing is your safety. And I'm like, I feel like I have a little piece of that. I feel really good about that, you know? So that's been very gratifying. But I wrote Street Sense over the course of 1983, yeah. 83, and it was released in 84 with a 1985 copyright. And I second editioned it in 1990. And at that point, I believe it was, there are two things that came in the second and the third edition. One was gangs, because they hadn't been part of the scene or the scenario or anything. It's a problem. And the next time around, I think it must have been it was cocaine on one of them and the gangs on the next one, or vice versa, I don't remember. Now with the fourth edition, which is just coming out, yay, in the end of this year, and about which I feel really good because the book hadn't been rewritten since 1996, so that's 20 years, and I have an MFA in writing since then, and I was rewriting this book, and I was like, oh, the writing in here is so bad. You know, so I was able to fix that and also begin to bring in social media and active shooter, and so I've sort of brought in a lot of the more modern phenomenon that have bubbled up. And also resiliency is a big piece of this now. I mean, we never taught resiliency. Now it's kind of a big part of the conversation. So I'm excited to have been part of this trajectory of change over time.
Fifth edition will have a museum in it.
Fifth edition? I might not live that long. I'm old. Yeah, that could be.
We step back to your dispatch days.
Sure, yes.
Because that is an untold story in EMS, and I think it's a crucial story.
Thank you for bringing
So I could rattle off a bunch of questions, or you start from the beginning
and start talking.
What got you into dispatch? What was the training like?
Oh, you're gonna love this. Okay.
I'm assuming it's here's the phone.
Hang on, right?
Kind of your experiences within that realm, and then we'll jump back and forth.
Super. I love that you brought that up. I finished journalism school in Boston, Boston University College of Communication. Go Terriers. Went back to Colorado, where I was trying to get back to all those years, and went and tried to find jobs as a journalist. I happened to have been very clinically depressed at the time, so I'm sure I went into these interviews going, I want to write for you. I really think it would be an exciting job. So nobody would hire me. And I was living in Vail because my family has been involved in Vail since it was being built from the ground up. And I went there, and a friend of mine was living with a woman who was a police dispatcher, and she said, hey, we're looking for a dispatcher. It was that simple. It was just fall into something. And I was doing the mountain rescue thing, so we were all sort of tied in together already. And oh, hey, I'll try that, and can't find a job writing. And I went over and got the job, had to type 35 words a minute. I never did learn how to type. I still don't know how to type, but I can do it because I'm a writer, so I passed the test. And let me set the scene for you. This is 1976 into 1977, right after the gondola fell in Vail, which was a mass casualty situation that I miss out on. The supervisor to this day is a good friend, and I still see her every time I go to Colorado, but Kay Cheney, and she sat me down with a dispatcher for a week and just said, just observe. And I watched all the various dispatchers that I sat with that week do the job. And whatever they happened to do, right or wrong, good or bad, didn't matter, watch them make all their mistakes. and every now and then a beeper would go off, and oh yeah, that's the da-da-da, or whatever, okay, good. And literally a week later, I started a shift schedule of 4 days on days, 4 days on evenings, 4 days on nights, 4 days off, 4 days on days, 4 days on evenings, 4 days on nights. That is, in my subsequent research on sleep and sleep research and shift work, is like one of the worst things you can do to your body. So I didn't last forever there at that job. But that's a different story. In the dispatch center, police, fire, state patrol that would wander through the valley, and police, fire, and ambulance. So we were 911. And also the counter, when people would wander into the police station, there was an open counter right there, and we would handle the parking tickets, and we did all the clerical work. And in my first few weeks there, other buzzers would go off, and like, I wonder what that is, no idea. And I was on day shift for the first little bit, so Kay could come over from her desk across the room and help me. And one day, I was there while a high-speed chase on the highway erupted. And so the 911 phone is like crazy going off. There's like and none of the radios were interconnected. Right. There was no such thing. We had telephones with dials. They're up in the residential district. They're on Chamonix Drive. They're on West Forest Road. I'm like, I'm like, I am immediately completely overwhelmed. I'm like, oh, what am I doing? And Kay came over, and I watched her just like, answer the phone, answer the radio, listen to this, do that, answer this because she heard that, da-da-da-da-da-da. And then 15 minutes later, this high-speed chase is like done. And I'm like, gobsmacked. I'm like, what just happened, right? And I remember we walked out to the steps outside, and she sat down, and she ordered a pizza to be delivered. And I burst into tears, and I thought, I will never be able to do this. I was so overwhelmed. And, I just was an example for me of like, okay, here I am, and here's what can be, and this is what I'm going to work towards. Yeah. So in the middle of all that, during that year, Gerry Ford was president of the United States, of course, and came to Vail as his vacation home. So the other really cool part of the job was working with the Secret Service. I have so much respect for those people. Oh, my gosh. So when Jerry would be coming into town, they would walk through, we had two jail cells in the basement, And they would store all their arsenal down in one of the jail cells, so they'd be walking through with their heavy bags and, hey, what's up, you know. So flirting with the Secret Service is fun. But we also got, in those days, it was a pretty big deal. We had a direct line to the White House operator in town. It was across town where he lived. And our little phone is up on the console. And then I have one more story after this. It was an old-fashioned phone. You'd pick it up, and it had a cord. And you'd, you know, but they would, you didn't have to dial the phone. It was just like, yes, this is the White House operator. And say, yes, there's a citizen who's coming to town that would like to meet the president. And I said, thank you very much. And I would hang up. And in the middle of the phone, they have those round, little round things. And it was a picture of the White House. And a few minutes later, Secret Service would come over and interview the citizen and put them on usually the next bus out of town. So that was a lot of fun. But then the third story I want to share is that in those days, of course, we did everything. So at 3 o'clock in the morning on a snowy night, we had a couple, three couples that were driving back from Las Vegas, stopped in Vail because they were running out of fuel at 3 in the morning. And they said, we have AAA. Can you call the AAA guy? Because, of course, there's no cell phones. There's no internet, right? And this is the 1970s, or now 1977. Oh, no problem, we call. So I called the AAA guy in town, and it took a while because it was snowy, and eventually it was three elderly couples. And I hear a bit of a commotion out in the lobby and by the door, and I look up, and the AAA guy's coming through the door holding a gun to the head of one of our elderly citizens. Boom. Walks him up to the desk, and he's just like having this meltdown. The AAA guy's having a meltdown. He's a crazy man. And so rule number one is, ever, your bladder's starting to get full, go to the bathroom now. Because like an hour and a half later, I had to kind of go to the bathroom, and it all started, and it was like, by the end of time, can you just put the gun down? I really need to pee. But anyway, so he sat at the open counter with the gun at the guy's head, and all he had to do was rotate it 2 inches to hit me, you know. And I don't remember being all that nervous. It was just kind of like, this isn't really happening, you know, what the hell, you know. And so and we used 10 codes in those days. I was a little bit rattled, and I had one cop out on bike patrol in the snow, had just gone into a building where he found an open door. And these guys did this all the time, and I was always like, there could be people in there that could hurt you, you know. I didn't like, you know. But they're like, it's Vail, come on. Yeah. And then the other patrol officer is out in the vehicle in the Saabs that they drove. And I said, I need you to return to the station immediately 10:30. Meaning, I wanted to say I'm having an emergency, which I think is 10:33. I may have this wrong after all these years. But I said 10:30, which is like the code for unnecessary use of radio. And no one had said anything on the radio for 15 minutes or so prior to this. So he's like, I wonder what that's all about. So a few minutes later, I hear him pulling up outside. And luckily, I had the presence of mind to say, he said, I'm here. And I said, use caution. And he looked through the windows and saw what was going on and was like, oh, what? This doesn't happen. Fail. You know, so I remember him coming through the door, service revolver deployed. Disarm yourself, sir. And I'm like, guy doesn't put the gun down. Disarm yourself, sir. And he put the gun down. You know, game over. So the things that happened were the dispatcher shortly thereafter. When I went back to visit a few years later, there was no, you didn't see the dispatcher when you walked in the lobby. There wasn't even protected. I remember that officer took the next night off because he was a little rattled. And in those days, you didn't really understand that. You're just like, what the hell? And so you pulled your gun. Yeah. You know, but then I thought, as I gained maturity, it's like, probably rattled him pretty good too, you know. Yeah, and always pee before you think you might need to.
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. Have you?
And then to just go forward with that. Around that time, it was in the 70s. Then I became a paramedic. I was working as a paramedic. Then I met the folks from GEMS. I met Keith and Jim Page in 1979 at a conference. Jim, my then husband. And I were both paramedics at Denver, and we had gone to New Orleans for this conference for fun. And there's Jim Page and Keith Griffith standing with a little hand-lettered sign in the hall saying, GEMS, Emergency Medical Services, Journal of Emergency Medical Services, coming soon. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. So I go up and, hey, you know, to Keith and this bald guy who turns into Jim Page, for heaven's sake, a close friend. I got a degree in journalism and I've been a paramedic for a couple of years. If there's anything you ever need, let me know, which is not the way to get an assignment. Keith, to his credit, leaned in and said, well, why don't you write down a couple of the ideas you'd like to write about? So in the next session, I'm like, this idea, I picked 10 ideas. And gave it to him, and the next week he called me with an assignment for money, you know. So I started, I was one of the first cover writers for GEMS for many years. I was able to you know, just be really engaged with bringing GEMS up as they brought me up, and was really, we bootstrapped each other. And fast forward to Street Sense coming out, and then at a conference around that time, this guy, Jeff Clausen, was writing in GEMS about this thing called Prior to Medical Dispatch. And I thought, that is cool. Because I, as a medic in Denver, I had literally gone all the way across the city of Denver on lights and sirens with a on a hangnail one time and on the hiccups another time. I thought, that's ridiculous. So Jeff's whole thing was, why don't we ask a few more questions and send the right response instead of sending the Marine Corps every time 911 lights up. I thought, that makes a lot of sense. I like it. So I bumped into him at this conference and I said, hey, why don't you have a book out? You need a book about your concept. And he's like hemming and hawing. It's like he didn't have time, didn't know how to write a book. He's a doctor, you know, and he had this amazing concept going. I said, why don't we chat, you know? So we chatted, and then he said, that could be good. So we ended up writing the what we call the Green Book, fondly referred to as the first edition of Principles of Emergency Medical Dispatch, was a little tiny 6x9, you know, paperback book called the Green Book. Subsequently has gone into this, and then computers hit. Computers hadn't hit yet, right? Much less cell phones, much less anything else. So Jeff's life work became Prior to Medical Dispatch, which is now International Academies of Emergency Dispatch, because they've gone into fire and police work dispatch as well, internationally. And the book is in, I think, the fourth or fifth edition. I have not been engaged rewriting the book with him, but we had a settlement that my name would always be on the cover, so it's kind of fun. So on the Chinese version and the German version, it's like, there's money. It's so fun. And I give them full credit for revolutionizing our world, because it is, send the right response. Ask a few more questions, send the right response. Yeah. And these days, it's getting to the point where we're not going to be even sending people with lights and sirens pretty soon. And it's a lot to do with what happens to that unseen hero called the dispatcher, who I bow to. You know, the dispatchers are amazing people. And they're just forgotten all the time. And I know, actually, our dispatch office in Michigan now is just, they can't find enough people. They can't type fast enough. People can't type anymore. They can text, but they can't type. And that's becoming a logistical issue for hiring people in.
That's really interesting.
Sorry. I just love to share this story. It was a dark and stormy night in Denver.
Best stories start that way.
And I-70 is elevated in many portions of Denver, and it had been sort of raining and sort of just cold. So the elevated portion of I-70 turned into an ice rink. So I got dispatched, and I think I was with Kevin. I think it was his name. Can't bring it up right now. He was driving. I was attending. And this is way before anything with, organized, you know, mass casualty response or even chain of command or what Alan Grunstein did in his work with incident command. But we got wind that there was kind of a bigger kind of crash, word was coming in. Because again, no cell phones at all, you know. So we elect, because it's on the westbound portion of I-70, we elect to go up the ramp the wrong way, the exit ramp from the westbound. I remember we were driving up the ramp the wrong way to get over to this accident. I looked over and I said, oh my God, there have to be 60 cars over there. And there were 59 car pileup. It was cold and it was raining and they were not small crashes, right? The best news of the night was that our 400-pound dispatcher was up and walking and ready to go to work. Yeah, Ray Norris. Bless him. He was a big boy, you know, and it was, hey, good job. So just trying to figure out. It didn't turn out that there were very many, you know, casualties, but I think we sent 15 people off with low-level injuries. Nobody was that bad. But that was a big moment. I I guess that one pretty close.
That is crazy. Fast forwarding past your time in dispatch, have you kept in contact or checked back in with, I know you had mentioned that typing is now an issue, are there other things in dispatch that would blow a researcher's mind?
I think
as it's progressed through the last 30
years. We had zero monitors. We didn't have a computer. We had a select type.
Okay.
We had the one that you could just hit the correct button and it would go back and put a little white. I was like, oh, that's cool. You know, it was electric too. Woo. And we did all the clerical work. I remember one time the chief needed a letter typed to the governor. And I'm not the best typist. I don't like the clerical part, right? But in the night shift was when a lot of that got done. And he came over and I handed him the letter and he held it up to the light and said, no, got two errors. Because you could see the whiteout. I was like, okay. So I had to type it again and no, not good enough. So I had to do it three times before it was perfect. But anyway. We had telephones and old-fashioned radios. And one night, I'm smelling smoke. We did have tapes. We were taping everything, and every 24 days we would recycle it, the old magnetic tapes that actually turned. I smelled smoke, and I couldn't figure out where it was coming from. It was not electrical smoke. So I called the fire department. It was 11:30 at night. Hey, guys, I think I have a fire over here in dispatch. And they said, well, what's burning? I said, I don't know what's burning. Come on over. I said, you see any smoke? No. Okay, call us back if you need us. What? Okay, thank you so much. And a few minutes later, I do have smoke, and it's from the demagnetizer, which is under the counter, and I have to like, oh, it's there. Hmm. So I unplugged it and took it out in the snow, and that was that, and they never did respond. I was like, thank you so much. What else? There's just the equipment. I go in for the fourth edition of Street Sense. I went into where I live in Michigan, it's Kent County. And I went into the Kent County Sheriff's Department Dispatch Center, which as a firefighter, I'm listening always to the Fire East channel, and I know their names. I know their voices and all this stuff. So I kept it super quiet in my work at Ada Fire. I told the chief when I was signing on, I said, so just want you to know that I kind of have a little bit of a national reputation in EMS. And just don't want it to be like broadcast because that's just the worst way to come in as a new guy. Like, I'm someone special. It's like, no, we're not going to tell anybody. So pretty much, that was on the lowdown the whole time I worked there. It kind of filtered out after a while. So then when I'm starting to rewrite the book, just last year, I actually came out as like, yeah, I kind of have done a few things nationally. And the guys are great where I've worked. I've loved my fire brothers at Ada Fire in Michigan. But I had the opportunity to call dispatch and also Life Ambulance let me come into their dispatch center. And the one picture in the book that I just love this picture, it's of a dispatcher with like literally seven screens. And it's just all technology. And it's like, it's all right in there. We didn't have headphones. We had to pick up the telephone and talk. Okay, so where are you? You know? So it's amazing the technology that's come through. They use a lot of the priority dispatch stuff, so you're hearing the questions being asked. It feels really validating. You know, there have been many, many good things that have happened over the years. There's a lot of stuff that we still have to do in the industry, but it's been fun to see the technology. We have to find the people that can have the staying power. There's a lot of that going on.
Do you think your 1976 self would stick out dispatch longer now?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. The training alone. I had a friend in Flint, Michigan, who was learning to be a 911 dispatcher. She was in the canine search and rescue world, and a wonderful woman, Pat Lampson. And one day at a canine training, a statewide one, she came up to me and said, so do you have a background in dispatch? I'm like, yeah, why do you ask? She said, well, I'm training to be a 911 dispatcher, and the book is by someone named Dernocoeur. And I'm like, yeah, that's me. Oh my God, you're famous. And I'm like, no, I just, shh. You know, so it was funny. I forgot your question.
If you would have stuck it out.
Oh, would I have stuck it out? Oh, yeah, so her training was lengthy. I mean, months. I'm like, wow. You know, and I have to say, too, EMS training-wise, the Great Lakes Academy for EMS, Steve Heisman was an old medic that I knew in Grand Rapids, Michigan, where you know I've been for the 30 years. I'm still a Colorado girl. He started this academy, and I just am so impressed with the people coming out of training. And today at my roundtable, we were talking about that. You know, the scenarios and the simulations and the ability to actually, like, feel what it is to... When I was learning to do IVs, it was like I was punching my fellow students, and they were punching me, right? When I did scuba diver training in 1970, whenever that was, 74, we, in the water for the first aid portion of scuba, we were literally doing mouth-to-mouth on each other. I had a guy blow into me, so I knew how that felt. Yeah, right? And it didn't feel creepy in those days. Nowadays, it's like, you did what? And I did mouth-to-mouth on him. It felt kind of a stranger kid in my class. And, okay, I don't think that would happen anymore. And we didn't wear gloves in Denver. We didn't wear gloves ever until after I left. And I, as soon as I got pregnant with my daughter, we haven't touched the women in the EMS thing, but I had been trying for 4 years, and it was like, I got pregnant, I was like, no, I'm going to send this up, and I quit like that day, you know? So when I went back and you had to wear gloves, it was like, I kept forgetting. I'm not afraid to touch blood, and I'm not afraid to touch bodily fluids. And even in my work as an MEI, I have to, and with Aid of Fire too, I mean, I've gotten pretty good at remembering the gloves, but I just still think it's kind of like, can't we just all wash our hands and save the planet from all the gloves?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's a whole other interesting conversation.
Topic.
That is interesting in
right.
a different way.
Yeah.
Awesome. So you actually just mentioned the women portion, so thinking about, and we don't have to stick with dispatch, but I'm so fascinated. we've hit a nerve. Were there men colleagues in dispatch? Was it just women colleagues?
Oh, yeah, dispatch was, well,
was
you were by yourself anyway. You were,
okay.
There was no one else, and then the cops. Yeah. And there was one female cop. So it was definitely, you know, the girls in dispatch and the guys out there. But I've always... It has not generally occurred to me to worry a lot about the gender piece, because I just believe that we're all humans, and you know, if you're a good human with good intentions and you want to do the right thing, I don't care who you are, what your gender is, what your color is, what your race, any of that. It's like, let's just meet as human beings. So I'm pretty adamant about that in my practice of being alive. But so dispatch was just women. Then when I was an EMT, I was among the only women. And that was a situation where you've got 24-hour shifts and you're sleeping, you know, basically in those days in the same room with the guy, because we had no separation of anything. It was a private ambulance. You know, you were $500 a month, woo, you know. And then when I got to Denver, it was 10-hour shifts, so you didn't sleep with the crew. But I was, I think, about the third female hired in Denver. The interesting thing there is that, first of all, I couldn't work as an EMT in Vail because they refused to hire women. And it was just known that you weren't ever going to get hired. So I just went to Denver. Now that changed pretty quickly after that, kind of super quick. And if it had changed just like 2 months sooner, I would maybe have spent my whole life in Vail. Yeah, it didn't happen. So I got to Denver, and I was about the third of the women that was hired at the city of Denver. And, you know, I don't remember having any issues exactly. I remember one scene where our patient was really concerned that I was female, my partner was female, and our student rider was female. And he wasn't worried about the medicine. He was worried about who's driving this thing. And I'm like, I'll be driving, and I've done it for a year. I mean, for many years, for a long time, I think I said. I'm fully capable of driving this thing. Who are you can drive? And I was like, what? You know, but we got him to the hospital safely. But however, in the 20 years of speaking that I was able to do because of Street Sense, people started calling and saying, hey, could you come talk about Street Sense at our conference? And I had a wonderful run of being able to go out into the world and sharing the passion for the Street Sense part. And I never want to stop speaking that message. Although many have spoken it now, and it's infused into the books, and it's infused into people's training, and it's infused into, you know, it's great. So I don't really need it anymore. So that's why I stepped away in 2003. But that said, for 20 years, from 1983 to 2003, I was on the conference circuit, and one of the things I would ask for when they invited me was like, I would like to ride a shift with your local people. So I have had a chance to see EMS and fire, mostly EMS, but fire, often fire-based, all over the place, internationally. Just and I stopped doing that after a while, but it was a great education for how differently things are done. We're doing the same thing, but we're doing it so differently from place to place. So in Michigan, when I was getting ready to sign up with the fire department, I actually technically live in the fire district known as Lowell, Michigan, but it was 7 miles down to their fire station, and they have a rule that you have to live within a certain distance of the fire station, so I wasn't even eligible. And besides, it was only 5 miles down to Ada, and I was only a few hundred yards out of the district, so it worked out, and they needed people up in the northeast side. As it turns out, there's three of us up in the northeast side, so you know we call ourselves Station 3A, because Station 3 was the party house. Station 2 is over on Napa, you know, near Egypt Valley Road. But anyway, so I knew that also that there's different flavors to different houses. And I knew that I had a sense that walking into Ada was going to be the most comfortable place for me as a woman. And honestly, I've never been made to feel other. I've never been made to feel like, well, their whole thing is that you were either all or nothing at Ada Fire. And what does that mean? When I was talking to the chief about joining, he said, well, you need it. He said, well, you need to be a firefighter. And I said, okay. He was not expecting me to say that. I was 58 years old at the time, right? And he's like, he spent like the next 2 hours trying to talk me out of it. He's like, well, you know, it's dangerous work. And I had already told him I had been a medic in Denver for years. And well, you could die. Good with that, you know. It's really funny. So once they took me in, the place is not about hazing the new guy. The place is more about like, let's make you the best firefighter you can be. And that doesn't matter if you're a female or a male. I've watched it with other newer people as well. Mostly. There's been a couple of situations that were bad fits for the house and the person didn't last. But I felt taken in. So And I would often point out, you know, like I'm not the biggest, I'm not the strongest. I do have a lot of experience in the medical side, which is most of what we do. We had others on the department too that were paramedic, or one was a PA. And so medically, we were very good. But I said, sometimes you need a little person. Sometimes you need a small person to get into little spaces. I would be that person, so don't forget that part, you know. Yeah. So we worked. I had a very good experience. Probably there would have situations where people more sensitive to what we call sexual harassment would have bristled. A couple of situations, just references to how I would eat a corn dog, you know, my partner back in the privates, you know, he made a reference. And all these years I'm like, you know, that's probably a sexual reference, but at the time, it was like, oh, Stella, shut up. You know, so I was the one of those. I was that kind of reaction to that kind of thing. And a few other times where it was just like, after, you know, another person might have thought of that as being inappropriate. You know, no, but nothing ever, anything that was something threatening or something that was really inappropriate. I have studied martial arts, and they knew that. So it's like, you know, just don't mess with me. It's not worth it. I can take care of you. You know, so I'm grateful for that. A little bit of a hard edge as a woman. I know that that's not true universally. And I would wish for women to know that they need to build the skill of having a little bit of a, you know, Teflon, like let it roll off, you know, unless it's super inappropriate. And then if it's getting inappropriate, know what to do about it. You've got to have the idea in your head that it always can happen. It's happened for millennia. Mm-hmm. You know, that women have been the subjects of harassment and worse. And so build the tools. Build the Teflon coat, build the communication tools of like, you're getting too close and this isn't appropriate, and not being afraid to say that, and having being assertive. I can be very assertive. I'm not aggressive, but I'm assertive, you know? And then having the, if you need it, the ability to get out of being physically restrained or forced. Mm-hmm. Don't wait to be the victim. Don't prepare thinking it's going to happen either, because they bring it on, you know, in a way. And that, I say that a little, like, lightly, but, you know, sometimes when you're like, so thinking this might happen, you can sort of, like, draw that energy in a way that's really kind of out there. But you know, people have intentions sometimes that you can't control. So be in control of what you can do about it. That's my message there, I guess.
And if collectively, where have women been, and where as a group can we go?
I think that it's very easy for us to generalize off of our individual experiences in life. And I don't think of myself as a woman first, EMS person second, just because it's who I am, you know? Take me as I am. And what's important is our community as of EMS. But that said, that is not true for everybody. And so individualizing an experience to say that all women, it's very difficult to generalize. And I love seeing that there's women in the fire service, there's an organization where we can go and have conversation about our collective experience and see what there is to be done about that. And I think that because women are still tend to be the minority in terms of gender equity in the field, one of the things I was always grateful in Denver was that I never questioned that Jim, my husband, and I we always made the same money. We did the same job. And that was never a question. And my big $500 a month, that was what everybody was getting, right? So in that sense, I think that possibly pay parity has been not gender-based. It hasn't been differentiated between the genders as much as it has been just that the entire EMS community is being disrespected financially by, you know, if you're the EMS guy in the firehouse, you're the bastard stepchild of the whole organization, even though you're the one running most of the calls. You're the chump who's getting out of bed. What the heck are you thinking? I'm only making 47 cents on the dollar I'm making. So that is a big, big issue that we all need to gather around. But the things for women, you know, having a separate bathroom, having a separate, I mean, do we really need to sleep in the same room? I don't think that's probably happening for people on 40, I hope not, on 24-hour shifts. Maybe it is still. And going to bat for one another when we do find out that there are things still happening. I don't have my ear to the rail on that so much, but I just think the EMS community is fighting a battle right now, especially around the pay, big enough that when we section off into the women in EMS versus the rest of us, you know, just don't let that dilute the bigger effort of the whole industry. I mean, it has gone from being something that was being invented when I was there in the 70s. And I think earlier than that, a lot of the time, if there were women showing up pre-1966, it's because I had a job in a nursing home and it was a family business or something, or maybe they had a first aid card and it was a volunteer setting. So I can't really speak to that era, but once things started getting standardized and nationalized and curriculum started being developed, and it went from being an exploration, an adventure, a new thing, to now we are in an industry. So we, you know, everybody has their fingers in the pie a little bit. So we need to make sure that if there's stuff happening for or get, you know, or to women that needs to be brought to the attention of the wider community, we need to be able to do that. You know, we need to have that voice. I'm less convinced that that's as big of an issue as it is the bigger issue that I tried to explain, if that helps.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's interesting in that other industries are certainly, I think they experience more of a gender divide when it comes to practitioner stuff.
Right.
But the macho culture is maybe a little more subtle, whereas first response has a macho front, but in the back end, everybody's treated exactly the same.
Like the bastard stepchild.
Yeah. Really, that's really fascinating theoretically. But, awesome. Moving into the future, you've been around to see trends.
I do.
Do you see any positive trends or any negative trends that may need to be stopped dead in their tracks?
Right. I think one of the most exciting things I've seen in a while is AJ and Bobby Halton on their speeches at the beginning of the conference here, getting so passionate, like feeling like I was at church listening to the sermons. Like, oh, you know. But they said stuff that's needed to be said, and that's again back to that, you know, why are the EMS folks in New York City getting 47 cents to the $1.10 per, you know, of the fire department and the 87 cents of the police? That is wrong, especially when you look at how much training we have to have and what it takes to stay and be there, to get there and stay there, is, I would say, more than either one of those other groups. I mean, both of those other groups have lots of training that they still have to do. I get that, appreciate it, honor it. But when you're deciding between this clear liquid and that clear liquid to put in this human being, you damn well better know what you're doing, because lives do hinge on what we do. And why are we only getting, you know, this is wrong that we've been treated this way. Mm-hmm. We've done it to ourselves, because we have a whole population of people saying, well, I'm just an EMT, I'm just an MFR. We are not just anything. We provide life-saving service once in a while. And the rest of the time, we provide service that people have asked for because they have been made to have a bad day, they're afraid, they're not sure how to move forward, and we're the ones that know, when you call 911, you know, as a human being, no human being likes to give up control over their life. When the shit hits the fan, and you call 911, you've said, you've admitted, I can't control this, and who is it that comes? It's us. You know, we have the skills, theoretically, and the ability to make the bad day better on whatever level, whether it's police, fire, or EMS, but most of the time it's EMS. And if it's EMS, it's a lot of the times it's like figuring out very subtle, physical, personal, intimate things. Touching a person, you know, starting an IV, touching for compassion, you know, reaching them mentally with good communication skills. These are things that need to have widespread understanding in the eyes of the public. They think, oh, we're the heroes. They'll come rescue us if they're going to die. You know, they forget that the other 991 calls, the 999 calls, are really just hand-holding or maybe a splint or maybe stop a little bleeding or pick up the finger that's been amputated. Not a big deal, but it sure feels like it to the person who's lost the finger, you know. We have to have such a broad range of capability, and it's easy to forget that. It's easy to get in the habit of like, well, medics only last 3 to 5 years and then they're done. Well, let's get over that. Let's have people that last because they understand that person that just had to give up control and call 911 that you came in, that was just as important as the defibrillation that brought the person back. It's cool to have someone sitting up and talking to you on the way to the hospital who was dead 5 minutes ago. Yeah. I get that. I've done that.
Yeah.
That'll nourish your little soul for a long time, right? Yeah. But if you can't figure out a way to find nourishment from the fact that you have the ability to be the one from 911 to show up, I'm sorry. And I think that's a cultural shift we need to make. And that will help us stay in. We also have to do the work of helping the public understand that piece is part of who we are as well. Mm-hmm. So that there's a little more balance in what the expectations are and appreciation for what it is we actually do.
Awesome. Yeah. If you had
a magic wand.
A magic wand. Ah, you got that one. If you were to have a group of brand new, just graduated medics sitting around the table, give them one or two lifelong pieces of advice that you want sitting back there, I'm going to give you a second to think about it.
What would I say to a group of graduating students for lifelong potential?
They have graduated. They're waiting for their first call.
Such an exciting time.
Yeah.
I think that the two things I would want to say would be never, ever, ever stop working towards mastery of what it is you've chosen to do. Because mastery comes in the medical skills, in the medical knowledge, in the updating of the medical skills and knowledge, because things change a lot in medicine. But it also comes in becoming a master communicator of all kinds of people in all kinds of situations, whether it's a routine transfer or, you know, hauling somebody up from, you know, 500 feet down on a crash, you know, on a hillside. So never stop learning, never stop mastering or paying attention to what it is you're doing. And that creates a lifelong learner. And be a lifelong learner, you know. And the other piece is to just, in combination with that, is just stay curious. Stay curious and take care of yourself. You know, don't give till it hurts. Give till you need to go take care of yourself. And stay curious about how you're going to do that. How are you going to stay in this business? You going to take care of yourself? You going to sleep enough? You going to try to find a place to work that actually pays enough that you don't have to have three jobs? You know, are you going to learn how to eat well? I mean, I'm really old and I'm just learning how to eat really well. And I've been doing really well, and I'm telling you, I'm out of pain because I've decreased the inflammation in my body in the last few weeks, and it's amazing. And I've been reading this book, Why We Sleep, by Matthew Walker. Read it. It'll teach you what you need to know about sleep, which I didn't know a lot of that stuff. So lifelong learner, be curious. You know, you're not done yet. You're just getting started. When a person gets their black belt in the martial arts, most of Americans think, oh, you've arrived, you got a black belt. You know, those who study the martial arts know that earning the black belt means that you've just finished being a beginner. So you've got the rest to go. Yeah.
You mentioned staying nourished throughout your career. Do you have good tips for staying nourished?
Yeah, I think staying nourished. I was talking to a bunch of people at a breakfast roundtable this morning saying, when you can make it happen, try to get to a national conference once a year if you want to stay in this business, because it will nourish you. It will reignite so much because you'll be around people from all over and learning stuff. I really believe that continuing education, good continuing education, but get out of your little box, get out of your blinders. Don't go to the same continuing ed every Monday, you know, first Monday of the month at the firehouse with the same guy. Because it may be very good, but it's not broad. So, yeah, nourish yourself that way. Nourish yourself by learning what it is to be well. And that is emotional, physical, logistical, financial, spiritual, all the wellness, all the wells. Dip into all the wells, you know, and do what it takes to be filled up. Don't just deplete all the time. You can't do that. If it's your family, then be with your family. Put the phones down and get nourish, talk, be in conversation. You know, whatever it is that fills you up, find what it is, and not counterproductive nourishment, like drinking too much or dropping into the drugs or, you know, numbing yourself with another round of the sitcom that you love. You know, physical fitness matters. We are occupational athletes. You know, if you think about it, it's a term that I love. I kind of heard it somewhere and I've adopted it because I'm an athlete. I don't compete in a sport. Well, I do compete in a sport, but yeah, I don't necessarily compete in a sport or you know, anything, but I am an occupational athlete. And if I don't know how to stretch and strengthen and do my cardiovascular, and if I don't do it, then I'm going to have to leave the field sooner than later. So it'll help you love it longer. So there's that, the mental stuff. There are hard calls. That's what we do. You know, our society's abnormal is why they call 911, right? That's our normal, right? Our abnormal is the, oh my God, 911s, right? So when we you get out to that, you have to know and have the presence of mind to look around your crew and into yourself and say, that one hurt. You know, and so it's not like it hurt and therefore I need to be burned out and leave. It's that one hurt and how can I be post-traumatic resilient as opposed to post-traumatic stress. And that's a choice that you make. It's work to be resilient. It's not something that you either have or don't have. It is work to be a resilient person. But if you know the skills, or if you have people that can help you learn how to be resilient, I think that's one of the biggest things right now. We have a generation of people that have had maybe not as much adversity as some other people in life. And that's not to shame or blame, is to say that we have a whole generation of people that don't know how to do the hard stuff. I have a cousin that used to fast forward through the hard parts of Disney movies for his kid because he didn't want to have to suffer seeing Bambi shot or Bambi's mom shot, whatever. You know, it's like, don't do that. You've got to know how to handle adversity and have tolerance for adversity. And that's not whether you're in EMS or not. That's you as a human. But in EMS, for sure, we need to know how to do this. So, yeah, moving forward, I think we need all those things.
Okay, so a bit of your experience with deciding family
versus career. And regarding the fact that EMS is both blue collar and white collar work, because you've got the blue collar part of the hefting and the lifting of equipment and walking with purpose to your patient, whether that's up a mountainside or up a stairwell or down into whatever. It's physical. Like I said, we're occupational athletes. And then the white collar side is deciding which clear liquid to give them on staying up with that. And then the perpetual question for a woman is, how are you going to do that with wanting to have children or having children or having young children or, you know, being a single mom? And balancing all that. You know, we're known to be master jugglers, right? Especially if you're early on as a mom and you're just trying to breastfeed, you know? I remember one, this is sort of an aside, but I was speaking to an EMS audience when my daughter was very young and I was still breastfeeding and I had a release. Luckily it was a dark colored dress. Yeah, this entire audience of several hundred people was watching me unload my breasts right into my dress. It was bad. Yeah, it was close toward the end. So I was able to, like when I was speaking though, negotiate with the organizer, say, I'll be bringing my daughter for the first 2 years to travel with me. And they would arrange a sitter and I would go do my thing and then be the mom. It's a little harder when you're on a 24-hour shift and trying to be a mom and pump. Oh my God, I hated pumping. So there are decisions to be made. And I would say that it's not possible to do it all. And at the same time, if you've worked hard to become whatever it is you are, you know, even if it's not in EMS, whatever your work is, as you know that the child part is coming, you're trying to find out, okay, what are my resources? I moved to Michigan. I didn't have any family there. I had no mom or auntie or anybody that said, hey, can you watch my daughter for a little while? I did find a wonderful woman, Sarah Tyler, who was available in a very not steady manner, but if I needed her for 5 days 1 week and just like an afternoon the next week, she was available. So that was almost the equivalent of having family. But, you know, I would encourage people to try to think it through, try to get a little ahead with the financial piece. If you can take the time off, I think, you know, your job will be there. I went back to the fire service at the age of 59. And I didn't need to be gone that long, but I had other things going on. But your child will only be a child once. Your child will only be little once. And if you're exhausted and you don't have the money and you don't have any time, but don't forget to look over this little being and connect regularly with like what a miracle you are, and make sure that child knows it's loved, and then know all the other skills of self-nurturing as well, because it's tricky as a mom, especially when you're a single mom. It's helpful ahead of time to have very frank conversations with the people that will be involved in childcare, especially if there's a spouse or a significant other. You know, okay, how's this going to actually work? So that you don't end up doing all the dishes and all the garbage at 11 at Mike's. Oh, tomorrow's garbage day. Whatever, you know. It's hard. I will say it's not easy, but the time passes, and all of a sudden you're really old, and you're looking back going, like, that wasn't so bad. Liar. But, you know, just try to be as mindful and deliberate and smart about it as we can. Try to choose when you have your children, you know, having them pop up, you know, inadvertently or unintended. That's always exciting, you know. Any unintended thing in life is interesting, but